so on, that have had wide circulation. He's also recorded a couple of songs and hosted a radio show. So he's really very active and multi-talented. And he taught for a while at the School of Social Research and he's been at the University of Massachusetts Amherst now since 1971, where he's a full professor in Judaic and Near Eastern Studies and an adjunct professor in the English and History departments. During that period that he's been there, he has received from the university a variety of commendations and awards: the Distinguished Teachers Award, Faculty Fellowship Award, the Chancellor's Medal, which is the university's highest honor. And in 1986, the Council for Advancement and Support of Education selected him as the Massachusetts State Professor of the Year. His most recent among his most recent books is one that you may be especially familiar with, A Love Song, Becoming a Jew, which has had a wide circulation. And How Many Spots Does a Leopard Have is another one of his recent books. And Falling Pieces of the Broken Sky, a collection of essays from a variety of years. And someone just told me just a couple of minutes ago that the bookstore has managed to find a group of his books and has a table ready after the lecture is over. I think it will be across the hall, through the lobby. The bookstore, as you know, is just on the other wing. So if you kind of, as you go out and turn into the lobby, just keep going across, and there will be some there. And which ones of his, we just heard about this, so I'm not sure exactly which ones are there, but I think you'll find an interesting collection, I'm sure. So.
Pleasure to be here. And what I'm going to do tonight is to give you a kind of an overview of how I see Black Jewish relations in this country. And at the end of it, make some suggestions for things that might be done. And then afterwards, there'll be some time for comments, responses, questions that you might have. To talk about Blacks and Jews is to talk not about politics, but the lives people live. After all, it is the lives we live that determine what we call our politics. And unless those lives are respected, there is no possibility of understanding the words we say to one another. In recent years, Jews and Blacks have disagreed often over each other's words. Neither has understood sufficiently that in so doing, they are disagreeing with each other's lives. Thus, Blacks have hurt Jews, and Jews have hurt Blacks. Lives are not philosophical premises with which one is allowed to disagree, or over which one can have an argument. Lives are sacred. They are God's attempt to create prayers of bone and flesh. All too often, however, Blacks and Jews regard each other as merely issues to be analyzed and debated. And when human beings reduce each other to abstractions, enmity must follow. And who should know this better than Jews and Blacks? First, let's acknowledge that Blacks and Jews have real and serious differences. Differences that may not be resolved by the most well-meaning of dialogues. But that's okay. Agreement is not a prerequisite for alliance. Understanding and respect are. A fundamental difference that Blacks and Jews need to understand is that each group views the history of Black-Jewish relations in radically different ways. Jews are convinced they have much in common with Blacks because the two groups share histories of oppression and suffering. But this Jewish version of Black Jewish histories is not shared by many Blacks. To the contrary, many Blacks feel they have nothing in common with Jews. And an examination of the historical record would indicate that both groups are right and both are also wrong. So what do blacks and Jews have in common? One, the histories of both begin in slavery. Two, throughout Western history, blacks and Jews have been subjected to stereotyping by the white majority. And often, the same stereotypes have been applied to both peoples. Jews and blacks have been equated with the devil and considered to have horns and tails. And Europeans stereotyped both groups as being sexually licentious. Number three, both have been physically segregated from the majority. The word ghetto was first used to describe the section of Venice where Jews were segregated from Gentiles in the 16th century. Ghetto is Italian for iron foundry because it was next to the iron foundry the Jews of Venice were forced to live. Number four, Jews and blacks suffered forced separation from their homelands and were dispersed throughout the Western world. Many blacks today refer to themselves as living in the diaspora, not recognizing perhaps that they are using a word from the Jewish experience to describe their own. However, there is a profound difference in the diaspora experience of Jews and blacks. Jews not only knew that Israel was their home, they kept Israel alive within themselves as a homeland for 2,000 years, a remarkable historical feat. For blacks, such a feat was not within the realm of possibility. Being brought to the so-called New World from so many different parts of Africa, blacks had no common language, no common past, no common memories. For American blacks, the diaspora is permanent. Number five, both have been politically subjugated, with laws being passed restricting their movement in society, choices of occupation, and social relationships. And number six, both have been subjected to heinous violence. The pogroms against Jews in Eastern Europe have a parallel in this country in violent attacks by whites on black communities during the first few decades of this century. And while blacks as a group have not been targeted, at least as yet, for extermination, as were Jews during the Third Reich, the number of Africans who perished during the centuries of the slave trade is staggering. A conservative historical estimate is 15 million. I can think of no two peoples who have endured so many of the same experiences throughout Western history. Both Jews and blacks have been condemned by the white majority, not because of anything we may have done, but because of who we are. We are condemned for being, and nothing we do can eradicate who we are. We are Jews, we are blacks, therefore we are other. The dominant society in whatever country we have lived has imposed a negative value on who we are. Jew and black are epithets in the vocabulary of the ruling majorities. In other words, we are looked upon and considered to be pariahs. Another similarity, then, is in how we've responded to being looked upon as pariahs. It is understandable, though not commendable, that many blacks and Jews have responded by attempting to assimilate. Some Jews have shortened or changed their names, while others have shortened or changed their noses. Some have intermarried and disappeared as Jews. And while a change of names would not help a black person, black magazines and newspapers still carry ads for creams to lighten the skin color and greases to straighten the hair. Some Jews take pride in being told that they don't look Jewish. And there are blacks who take pride in being told, well, you're different, you aren't like those others. But unless one removes him or herself completely from the dominant society, it is impossible not to internalize some of the oppressive value system. And blacks and Jews share much in how they resist and fight back against an oppressive value structure and preserve a sense of self and peoplehood independent of pariah status. For example, look at comedy in America. Is it an accident that many of the most original and creative comedians in America are either Jewish or black? Lenny Bruce and Richard Pryor could have been brothers. Without Jews and blacks, I wonder sometimes if there would even be laughter in America. In their broad histories, then, Jews and blacks have many similarities, both in historical experiences and their responses to those experiences. So similar are some of the experiences that blacks use words from Jewish history to describe their own. These similarities are important, and neither blacks or Jews are enough aware of them. And I would like to believe that if we know and love what we share, it will be easier to talk about and accept the differences. However, the differences are profound. The broad historical similarities I have just described are true. And it is these which Jews point to when they speak of what blacks and Jews share. However, these similarities are not, for the most part, the shared experiences of American Jews and American blacks. Instead, they describe the histories of European Jews and American blacks. In other words, in the broad context of Western history, Jewish and black histories have many similarities. While similarity of experience is important, a similarity of experience is not the same as shared experience. And this is the crucial difference, of which many blacks are keenly aware and many Jews are not. Jews and blacks have parallel historical experiences in the broad context of Western civilization. They do not, however, share experiences common to both people in the same time and the same place. The Jewish assumption of shared historical experience makes communicating with and listening to blacks very difficult. Another assumption made by Jews is that all black anti-Semitic expression is identical to that anti-Semitism expressed throughout European history. But this is not always so. Some black anti-Semitic expression stems from the volatile and unstable socioeconomic environment in America today. Although the words are anti-Semitic, the content may not be. But this may be difficult for many Jews to understand, given the realities of Jewish history. But making this distinction will enable American Jewry to modify its approaches to black anti-Semitism and black Jewish relations. It is crucial that all of us pay closer attention to the particularities of American history and culture, and especially the challenges facing our nation today. And so what I want to do is to outline briefly the wider context from which I see black anti-Semitic expression as stemming. America is presently undergoing the most profound cultural changes since the Emancipation Proclamation. These changes are confronting us with the challenge of redefining what it means to be an American. Non-white ethnic groups are demanding school curricula be reconceptualized and rewritten. Under the guise of a principle of inclusion called multiculturalism, these groups are demanding that Western culture and civilization in the curricula be replaced by an African-centered curricula, or one in which the cultures of the so-called peoples of color will be dominant. Now, regardless of how one critiques Afrocentrism and multiculturalism, they reflect the enormous demographic changes taking place in our nation. Within the first two decades of the next century, demographers predict that in the aggregate, African Americans, Hispanics, and Asians will outnumber whites. For the first time in the nation's history, then, whites will be in the minority. The This means then that America will have to reconceptualize itself from the white Anglo-Saxon Protestant image in which it was created. On the one hand, we are being given a tremendous opportunity. America could become the first genuinely heterogeneous nation in the history of humanity, bringing together people from every country on the globe and creating a new whole. However, there is a danger that America could disintegrate into ethnic enclaves as much of Eastern Europe is doing. But if instead of engaging in actual warfare, the American one would set groups against groups in a psychological cold war in which each group defends its psychic turf against all other groups. Today, ethnic identity is becoming a substitute for personal identity. For many American blacks, the declaration that I am an African American is an article of faith, resonating in the very depths of the soul. This declaration gives the individual a positive collective identity, which seeks to offset the negative onus being black has had in Western culture. But one should not be deceived that the aggressive articulation of a positive collective identity has done much to dispel the demons of racial self-hatred in the black psyche. On the surface, Afrocentrism may sound like a necessary historical corrective to the centuries of Eurocentrism. Afrocentrism posits that Africa and Africans, and by implication, therefore, African Americans, are the matrix from which all civilization came, that the ancient Egyptians were black, that the concept of monotheism originated in Egypt, that Moses was a black man, and therefore Judaism was a black religion stolen from Africans and perverted by whites. Now one is tempted to leap to the library shelves and prepare refutations. But to do so would miss the deeper realities of despair and hopelessness about who and what one is that makes it necessary to recreate history in one's own image. There is in black America today a nihilism heretofore unknown in American history. It is not a philosophical and political nihilism. It is a nihilism born from the absence of self and the absence of hope. It is a condition without precedent in black American history, because even during slavery, blacks had hope because they believed in a merciful deity and redemptive suffering. Today, however, God is dead and suffering is for fools. This nihilism is one of the factors underlying the thrust to Afrocentrism and black anti-Semitism. The issue is no longer one of tensions between blacks and Jews. Jews are merely the lightning rod making visible a loss of self and a consequent violent desperation that we ignore at our peril. Now, such an analysis is not meant to exculpate those who lack the moral sensibility to know that public anti-Semitic expression is as unacceptable as anti-black racist expression. But there is a moral double standard in our nation that tends to tolerate anti-Semitic expression while condemning speech that is anti-black. All too many black leaders have failed to understand that tolerance of anti-Semitic expression helps create an environment in which anti-black racist expression will also be acceptable. If blacks are serious in wanting to end racism, and I'm not certain that that's a practical goal, it is in the black self-interest to be in the forefront of those speaking out against black anti-Semitism. It is in the Jewish self-interest to see black anti-Semitism not from a European context, but from within the complexities of American life today. Not only are we in the midst of great ethnic change, But the American black community finds itself in the position of being economically surpassed generation after generation by successive waves of immigrants, the most recent ones being Indians, Pakistanis, Arabs, Koreans, Vietnamese, and Cambodians. Now, the immigrant success story is the quintessential American paradigm, and it is a story in which black Americans have had their noses rubbed for all too long. The lesson of the story generally goes something like this. Well, you see, well, my ancestors came here and they had nothing. Well, they couldn't even speak English, but they made it. So if you people haven't made it, well, it's your fault. But to cite the immigrant experience as the paradigm is to ignore the legacy of slavery. Part of that legacy is a record of black achievement that is absolutely stunning when we consider that blacks of my generation are a little more than 100 years removed from slavery. But we who have achieved are not the whole story. To cite the immigrant experience as the paradigm is to be blind to the intractability of color prejudice in American society. In a 1988 study of racial attitudes conducted by the National Research Council, the conclusion was reached, quote, "The status of blacks relative to whites has stagnated or regressed since the early 1970s, and that the ideals of equal opportunity and equal treatment for blacks were not endorsed by whites when it would result in close, frequent, or prolonged contact with blacks." Much of black anti-Semitic expression is a desperate attempt to be heard by people who do not have a language. If they hurl epithets at white people, white America doesn't listen. Say something anti-Semitic, however, and Jews will hear. Black anti-Semitic expression draws attention to the speaker. It does not matter if that attention is negative. Negative attention is better than none at all. Under the glare of approbation, one becomes visible. Perhaps nothing has made blacks more visible recently than the 1992 riots in Los Angeles. Now, if Jewish stores, rather than Korean ones, had been looted and burned during those riots, Jews would have called the riots a pogrom, and that would have been a mistake. Over the past few years, there have been protests against Korean store owners in Los Angeles and New York, and against Indians, Pakistanis, and Arabs in other locales. And sometimes the language of the black protesters has been racist. These protests, like the LA riots, are the have-nots striking out at the haves, or at those who appear to have. The violence of the LA riots might have been averted if America had not been so callously indifferent to the cold statistics which tell us that the largest causes of death for young black men are either murder or suicide. A significant part of black America has been killing itself for 2 decades. And yet these facts do not produce anything remotely like the outcry that comes when some black utters anti-Semitic obscenities. Much of black anti-Semitic expression is the ugly and desperate agony of those who cannot hope because they cannot dream. Because to hope and to dream, one must feel secure about his and her place on the earth. Without existential security, one either becomes free or one goes mad. And I would suggest that in black America today, there are pockets of collective madness. I wonder if we have not reached that point in time when an emphasis on black-Jewish relations is not misplaced. We can no longer afford to be nostalgic for the golden days of black Jewish harmony and cooperation, which were not as harmonious as hindsight would have us believe. The political challenge for all of us is to create broad-based coalitions across the ethnic spectrum. None of us wants to see anti-black racist or anti-Semitic expression coming in a generation or two from the descendants of today's Hispanic and Asian immigrants. But American Jewry can only participate in new coalition building if it understands that it is no longer an offshoot of German or East European Jewry. American Jewry is its own entity now, one unlike any Jewry that has ever been. In Europe, Jews had a distinct identity as Jews and were seen as a minority. In America, the distinctiveness of that identity has been moderated because there is another group whose distinctiveness is more marked, namely blacks. In America, Jews became white because there existed a people called blacks. Regardless of the extent to which an individual may regard her or himself a Jew, when she or he walks down the street, they blend in with the majority. In a crowd, white-skinned Jews look white. Because Jews partake of and share in the majority identity as whites, they have benefited economically. In Europe, Jews were victims. In America, Jews became a success story. Understandably, the very success makes many Jews nervous, because the Jews of Weimar Germany were also a success story. And we know what happened to them in less historical time than it takes to blink the eyes. There are not many Jews sanguine enough to think that the same could not happen here. However, from a black perspective, there is something jarring in hearing white-skinned Jews talk about suffering. No black denies that Jews suffered in Europe, but the Jewish experience in America has not, for the most part, been characterized by such suffering. The black experience has. Many blacks feel that Jews borrow suffering from history to give themselves an identity and status as victims, and then use this vicarious suffering as the credentials to give themselves the right to express empathy with blacks. Thus, what often comes out as black anti-Semitism is an attempt to express resentment toward Jews for assuming a relationship of shared suffering. As far as many young blacks are concerned, no such relationship exists. They resent the Jewish assumption of shared oppression and use the language of anti-Semitism to make that resentment clear. This absence of shared suffering can be illustrated by many statistics, but I'll cite just two that I find to be the most chilling. One, blacks comprise 12% of the population. Blacks account for 45% of all deaths by fire. Number two, 47% of all black 17-year-olds are functionally illiterate. Now, I want you to imagine a black woman living in the innards of any American city. I want you to imagine her living in a tenement that is a veritable fire trap. I want you to imagine her with her children and the rats and the roaches, subsisting on welfare with no hope or prospect of ever being employed or ever being able to change her condition. I want you to imagine her trying to understand why she's in this situation. I want you to imagine her trying to explain to her children why they will never be a part of the middle class world depicted on the TV screen. But she doesn't know why. Then, one day, along comes a black demagogue. And he knows who is to blame. It is the Jew. If we are dismayed that so many blacks listen to demagogues, it is because only the demagogues are speaking to the despair and hopelessness of those trapped in poverty and ignorance. Unfortunately, too often, Jews unwittingly enhance the status of such black anti-Semites. One could almost say that if you're black and want to be considered a leader in certain parts of black America today, then say something anti-Semitic and get attacked by ADL. It is time to stop assisting black anti-Semites in their thirst for attention. Denunciations of black anti-Semitism are in danger of being counterproductive. Equally, I wonder if it is useful any longer to talk of black-Jewish tensions. Yes, they exist, but are they the problem? Isn't the problem that a significant number of American citizens, namely blacks, believe in nothing and no one, and are incapable of becoming productive members of a society because they lack the even rudimentary skill of literacy? But perhaps it's time we stop speaking of a black problem and began talking about an American problem. Because blacks are American citizens, to state an obvious fact that America simply has not grasped. The alienation, anger, resentment, despair, and hopelessness of significant numbers of blacks finds expression in the vileness of anti-Semitism. Denunciations of anti-black Semitism are not enough because anti-Semitism is not the whole problem. The time has come then when the plight of black America must be moved to a place of high priority on the national agenda. This time it will not be done from any sense of liberal do-gooderism or from any misplaced feelings of empathy or sympathy. This time, all of us must act from our self-interest as Americans. The quality of all our lives, blacks and whites, Jews and Gentiles, is threatened because there are all too many other Americans who are not economically viable. Can you imagine the hatred felt by one who knows that he or she is of absolutely no use socially, economically, politically? Can you imagine the rage in one who knows that his or her existence simply does not matter? This is the context of today's black anti-Semitism. We should not be surprised or dismayed that so many blacks hate Jews. They hate themselves far, far more. Self-hatred and despair are not justifications for black anti-Semitism. And all too many black intellectuals, artists, political, and business leaders have been silent in the face of black anti-Semitic expression. And all too often they have sought to justify it by saying such things as, oppressed people can't be racist, or we are not anti-Semitic because Arabs are Semites. Such statements would be laughable if they were not so obscenely immoral. Black leaders have failed when they have not spoken out and said that anti-Semitism damages the black soul as surely as anti-black racism damages the white soul. That, in the words of James Baldwin, it is a terrible and inexorable law that one cannot deny the humility, the humanity of another without diminishing one's own. In the face of one's victim, one sees oneself. It is so simple a fact and one that is so hard apparently to grasp. Whoever debases others is debasing himself. Today, black America is living in an economic depression that can only get worse. This depression is further complicated by racism and by national and systemic problems. I see only one meaning in the never-ending grand statistics about life in Black America. Namely, that America does not care about Black life. America does not care how Black people live. It does not care if Black people live. This is the Black reality. And to speak of Black-Jewish relations without addressing the concrete despair of Blacks is to indulge in nostalgia for a time that never was. Poverty does not ennoble, it embitters. It embitters until people are left with no power except the power of hatred and destruction. If there is to be any kind of new Black-Jewish coalition, it must first put aside sentimental notions that there is some kind of God-ordained bond shared by Blacks and Jews. The notion that Blacks and Jews should be friends is romanticism at its worst. There is a hopelessness and despair in Black America today which is indescribable. It is short-sighted for white America, including American Jewry, to think that Black poverty is a Black problem. Black poverty is a national problem. It is a problem of such scope that it has the potential to endanger the life of the nation. Those Black gangs which are now killing Blacks will one day in the near future start randomly killing whites. It is in the self-interest then of Blacks and Jews and whites to come together and seriously address the issues of Black poverty, unemployment, education, etc. Let me close by suggesting a possible course of action. The economic problems of Black America must be taken seriously, even at a time when the nation as a whole seems to be coming out of its economic crisis. But what has been a crisis in the nation has been and is unmitigated catastrophe in Black America. So the nation must be awakened to the danger represented by this poverty. The annual reports put out by the NAACP and the Urban League on the state of Black America are worthy of study and of being taken seriously. The first step then would be to educate white America to the realities of Black America and the implications for the nation as a whole. Such might be done through a call to conscience and responsibility issued by the major denominations of Christianity and the branches of Judaism. And such a statement would be read from pulpits and bemas with follow-up workshops and study sessions. The second step would be to identify areas of common interest that can be worked on at the local level. It is in the self-interest of white and Jewish and Black Americans that the cities be clean and safe. It is in the self-interest of white and Jewish and Black Americans that drug use be eliminated. It is in the self-interest of white and Jewish and Black Americans that all citizens be literate. Number three, it is a mistake to think that any expression of anti-Semitism is a problem for Jews to combat. The reality is quite the contrary. Anti-Semitism is a problem created and continued by Gentiles. Public anti-Semitic expression will only be curtailed when Gentiles, Black and white, recognize that any kind of racist expression damages the society, not only the group denigrated. What needs to be done then is that we save ourselves, Blacks and whites, Jews and Gentiles. The kinds of activities I am suggesting cannot be accomplished in a year, a decade, or even a generation. But unless such activities are begun, the nihilism swallowing ever larger portions of Black America will eventually swallow us whole. sometimes we become so focused on our lives as blacks and Jews or whatever, that we forget that such particulars are not the totality of who we are. What we share and what we must acknowledge that we share is a common humanity and common aspirations for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Perhaps it is time then that all of us, blacks and white, Jews and Gentiles, enlarge our visions beyond our particular pains. Perhaps it is time that all of us, blacks and white, Jews and Gentiles, come together to address ourselves to the pain of our nation. Several comments. One is that I think that a black person would find your statement that Jews suffered as much as blacks to be offensive. There's a difference between being an immigrant and being descendants of slaves. And being a descendant of a slave carries a negative onus in the skin color.
Go back to Egypt, you can also talk to slavery.
Sir, we're talking between 3,500 years and 100 years. There's no comparison. My great-grandparents, I know, were slaves, three of them were. And so that's quite different than, you know, so that I think I understand your comparison. I did not in any way mean to make light of the prejudice that Jews encountered in this country. But the fact remains that when that next generation did not have the access, that things began to change. And certainly in the 1950s, when Jews moved into the suburbs, this, that, and the other. And so we reach the point now when the biggest issue in the Jewish community is what? Assimilation. Okay? That's the danger facing the Jewish community now. It's not black anti-Semitism, it's assimilation. And so that Jews can become white American and disappear as Jews. Skin color makes that impossible for blacks. And so therefore, color prejudice renews itself generation after generation, decade after decade. There's a profound difference. Secondly, the assumption is always made that blacks do not involve themselves in self-help. And that far as you can go back to the 1830s and you find black self-help organizations that are on akin with the Jewish self-help organizations. Black churches, black fraternities, black sororities have for decades been involved in all kinds of projects, scholarship programs, you know, what have you, in terms of the black community. And so that just because it's not reported in the mainstream press doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. And that, you know, I wish that something perhaps a favor that non-blacks could do themselves would be to subscribe to a black newspaper or a black magazine so they would know more about the kinds of things that do go on. The number of black athletes who are involved, you know, who start their own foundations and do things is quite considerable nowadays. And so that blacks do considerably. Finally, once again, to say that Jews made it under their own efforts is once again not to take into account certain historical realities. That Jews made it at a time when the economy was expanding. The economy is contracting now. We have this awful term in America. I mean, you have to follow language. We have this awful term in America, downsizing. What does downsizing mean? Downsizing means folks are being fired. But we say the company's downsizing rather than looking at the suffering that's being caused by it. And so, and then once again, it's astounding to me, the quote that I cited from the National Research Council, that over 70% of whites do not favor black equal opportunity if they have to have close contact with blacks. And that astounds me in 1988 that should be the reality. And so color prejudice in America seems to be intractable. It will not. And there's nothing, black people have no power to change that. White people have to change that. Nothing I can do about it.
You did not discuss the role of the Muslim religion, Islam, which seems to have some ways been replacing Christianity and its influence in the black community. Both in terms of psychological terms and hope, in terms also of maybe the politics of the Middle East and the role of anti-Semitism here.
Yeah, sure. I didn't discuss Islam because in terms of black Jewish changes, I really don't think that, at least there's no evidence at present time that's coming from Islam. My comments would be general comments, which is that Islam is the fastest growing religion in America, that demographers predict that sometime in the next decade or two, it will be the second largest religion in America. Most major American cities now have mosques being built in them, and that 90% of converts to Islam are American blacks. And that this is Islam, this is legitimate Islam, this is not Farrakhan's brand of Islam. And that my own contacts with the Islamic communities have certainly been, few, but they have been cordial. That they are people who are seekers like myself, and they have found what brings order to their lives, and they know I'm a Jew, and I've not had any difficulties or tensions with any Muslims that I know in this country. And so that's why I left them out of my analysis, because I don't see them as playing a part in it right now.
First of all, I'd like to thank you very much for a particular insight that I learned from you tonight, which I haven't read in all the essays I've been reading. One thing I learned very early as a pastor is that the worst thing you can say to someone who's just suffered a terrible tragedy and feels a loss is to say to them, I know exactly how you feel. And
it's true.
I want to try to be careful about that in terms of what the Jewish community says to the black community in the future. That's a really valuable insight. Secondly, I wonder if you would comment on something which is maybe tangential to your talk, but very important in terms of broader American politics, which is the extent to which radical left whites, particularly in the intellectual and academic community, seems to have virtually welcomed and certainly embraced black anti-Semitism wherever they can discover it.
Well, I guess I would have difficulty commenting on that because I don't see that there is a radical left anymore. anything resembling a radical left is basically folks I knew from the 60s who wanted to get the glory days back. And
I just seem to bump into them. Not too many of them.
Yeah, I honestly just simply do not see. I mean, the radical left, certainly in the late 60s, did embrace anti-Zionist positions. And unfortunately, a lot of those radicals who did that were Jews. And but you know, honestly, don't encounter that anymore. So I really can't, you know, I really can't comment. I mean, I think the left in this country is basically irrelevant now. And I apologize to any leftists out there for hoping I was coming to bring them a, you know, message of hope and fire and what have you, but I simply can't do that.
There's a sensitivity that I felt tonight from what you had to say, which convinces me that the black experience in America is different than the Jewish experience in America. And in essence, it's insulting to compare the black experience as anything other than a unique experience. I feel when people say from a plane of their own experience what the rabbi stated, we know how to feel, okay? That's missing the whole point you made. And the thought that you kindled in me was the fact that when we generalize and said look at lives or look at different ethnic groups, because they are different by their own unique experience, we are looking past the problem and we'll never face it. And I think your words got that idea kindled, at least in me. And it's a nice beginning on how to look at a situation that should be handled constructively. And it seems to be the thing that we have to attack is the reality of despair, which there's reasons for despair.
Yeah.
So I thank you for what you told me.
You're welcome. Thank you for listening so well. Yeah, the despair has to be, if people don't have hope, then we really can't expect anything from them except destruction and self-destruction.
Like if you, black anti-Semitism, from that point of view, if Jewish people say, look, we've got past your experience, rather than taking the trouble to see the differences, that's a way to have a reaction.
You told us how things became the way they are, and you told us how to solve the problem. How long will we have to wait until the messianic age comes and we will benefit by your good advice?
Well, I guess I must demur. I did not, you know, there's a lot more in terms of where the problem came from, and certainly what I offer is by way of suggestion only. How long we must wait depends upon us. We don't have to wait any time at all. It really depends upon us. We have fallen into this thing in this country of looking to the mayor's office or the state capitol or, God forbid, Washington to solve the problems. But as a veteran of the civil rights movement, I know that the civil rights movement did not begin in Washington or in the mayor's office or in the governor's office. It began when some folks said, we've had enough. We want to change the situation. We're willing to risk our lives to change the situation. And blacks and whites and Jews and Catholics, we did that. And so how long we have to wait really depends on us. We have no one to blame but ourselves. And when I talk about this, you know, I want you to hear me when I'm saying that this is not a black problem, this is not a Jewish problem, we're talking about a national problem. Where is our nation going? We determine that. If we wait, new opinions will determine.
I think you're probably right that not too much to happen in our middle class suburbs in terms of changing this attitude. I guess what I would ask is, do you see on college campus, since we know
down.
It's been going down.
Going down.
I guess my question would be, do you see any change in the attitudes of the college students in terms of this whole problem?
No, I mean, colleges are, I think colleges are pretty much, you know, broken up into ethnic enclaves now. I mean, colleges are probably the worst places. I think that one of the eras that we may have fallen into in this country is asking children to solve our social problems. You know, I felt that the 1954 Supreme Court decision erred grievously when it put the burden of desegregation on children. The problems are ours as adults to solve. And if we take responsibility, then the children are free to be what they are, which is children. And so that, you know, what I see is the kids come to campuses, and what do? They bring the attitudes of their parents. That's all they can have. The attitudes of their parents to the campus. On the campus, campuses are great places. I love to watch. I actually hate to drive around a college campus because college students walk as if they're immortal. You know, they step out in the traffic as if they know that they have privilege you don't dare get from them. And so they come to campus, they have privilege, they can act out, they can carry on, they can say all kinds of things, they can invite all kinds of speakers, and know that no one will do anything to them. And so I wonder sometimes if unconsciously the nation doesn't use college students to act out the things the adults know they bet not act. And so that I see people blame colleges. I see colleges as giving us a window on the soul of America. And if this is the generation that's coming up to leadership, I believe in prayer, but I can pray in two languages, but. Yes, sir.
How do you deal with the Lewis Farrakhan's associate?
It doesn't make any difference.
The Sonny Carsons of New York, the professor at City College of New York,
yeah,
who are appealing to the youth of the black community. They are the ones who are following these people. How do we straighten out those problems when the youth are going to follow the militants, not the negotiators?
Well, I think you noticed that I made a point of not mentioning anybody by name.
I guess I made a mistake and did.
And the reason I didn't is because it is not the fact that those individuals speak. It is, as you implied, that others listen. And so the thrust of my remark was, why are these people listening? And so that there's nothing that can be done to change a Farrakhan or Abdul Malik, you know, whoever, you know, you can't change them. I wouldn't bother to change them. Which is why I would not bother to get involved in trying to get people to denounce them or what happened. You know, ignore them. What they want is attention. And so I refuse to give them the attention. And so that I suggest to college students, you know, Jewish college students, that if Farrakhan is coming to campus, don't go out and protest. The same night Farrakhan's on campus, outside the auditorium where he's speaking, have a festival that's really dancing. You know, don't get involved in being angry at him. Get involved in affirming who you are. And I think that would upset Farrakhan much more than our getting angry at him and calling him names. He can deal with that. Our joy in the face of his stuff, that he can't deal with. And so that, you have to understand, you know, to speak of college students is one thing, but you have to remember also that there are 17-year-olds, 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds, right? And that's not to put anything down, but to put it in perspective. And so part of the reason they're at college is to try on this idea, try on that idea, try on that idea. We all did it. We didn't parade it in the street. The 60s made it okay to parade our neuroses in the streets, and so we've been doing it ever since. But that's what you do when you're in college. Let's just tell you when you're in college. So I want to be here, Farrakhan. Everybody else is in college. Listen to him. One, two, and you're the last three. You're the last three.
Could you speak a little bit about that balkanization? Address yourself to what you think we might be doing to advance and obviously to inhibit it in some way.
I talked about that we have an opportunity in this country to become the first genuinely heterogeneous nation in the world's history, or that we could break down into an ethnic balkanization. And that's what I see, you know, happening, basically. I think it's coming about because we are a nation at the present time which in a very real sense is in chaos. That the old definitions of what it was to be an American simply don't apply anymore. And we don't have any new definitions to replace it. So what we have on the one hand is we have people like Gingrich and others and the Christian right and what have you asserting a fundamentalism, a political fundamentalism, a religious fundamentalism, which is the old definitions. And we don't have an alternative to replace it with. All we have is and so that we do have, you know, multiculturalism and this, that, and the other, which I'm not convinced that is the way to go. That is the way to go either. My response is not a comforting one, but it seems, I think it's the only thing that we can do, which is to learn to dance in the chaos. And just to hang on and to live through whatever this period is until the new definitions and ways of being themselves. And that's not comforting. That's not an answer, a definite answer. People want definites. I don't know that we can have that anymore. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to share an experience I had in the 1950s. I lived in California and I taught in an all-black elementary school.